Thank you, everybody, for coming in this evening. It's an absolute a delight and pleasure to welcome this evening Rahul Mehrotra to the Architectural Association, I think for a first-ever lecture here at the AA, and the first of what I know will be many in the future. As we all know, Indian architects today face a gamut of challenges that are those of many other places, the challenges of economic development, social conditions, the local culture and practice within the profession, how those mix together in India is simply unbelievable, I think, for most of us who are accustomed to other settings. I think Rahul's work has always sought to engage the complex role of architecture within many different disciplines, in many different fields, in incredibly inventive and intelligent and critical ways. His work has done that from its beginning over the last 20 years, has matured around not just built projects commissioned by an incredible range of different clients, institutional, governmental, private development, local community, and others, but also through a series of projects that he's very much initiated on his own within his home studio. And the balance of knowledge and learning across that spectrum, I think, is truly, truly remarkable and a model for architects in many places well beyond the Indian settings that he's brought this work to. I was in India about 2 months ago on a tour of several cities in as many days, and over and over again confronted with the complexity of architectural work that simply staggers the mind. One of my graduates from the AA, who was with us here about 5 years ago and is trying to juggle the managing of an office with 20 or 30 people in what seemed like open warfare, competing with other offices at this early stage of his life, got off the phone one afternoon to say that a client of his had just agreed that he would commission our graduate to begin work on the design of this project if he could promise that that project would be on site in 2.5 months. And if on site in 2.5 months, that client would then speak to the current owner of that site to purchase it. And if that purchase was complete, he would then talk to local planning authorities to secure permission to do this project. And the AA graduate hung up with absolute calm in his voice to say, this is just the way things work here. Simply astonishing that a generation today, and not a small generation, is going forward to face the challenges of a new setting in a place like India in new and remarkable ways. Tonight's lecture is going to present a combination of Rahul's experience and work within the office, and particularly work within Mumbai, and with lessons gleaned from that experience, talk about the way in the second half of the lecture that experience connects to projects that he's been pursuing with the studio all across India. This is the second of recent talks at the A that brings architects from India here to audiences in London, and I have to thank the British School at Rome for helping make this visit possible. Rahul visits us, having just gone to an exhibition there that just opened in Rome, and it's a real pleasure and a delight to introduce the work to all of you here in London. Rahul is an architect, an urban designer, and a teacher. He established his office, RMA, a little over 20 years ago in Mumbai, and as I said, completed a wide range of projects throughout India. He was the executive director of the Urban Design Research Institute in Mumbai, which he remains a trustee of today. He studied at SEPT and later at the Graduate School of Design at Harvard, where he completed a master's in urban design, and he's currently a member of the steering committee of the South Asian Initiative at the GSD and head of the planning department there. Please join me in welcoming Rahul Mehrotra.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Britt, and it's a real pleasure to be here in London and at the AA. A real honor, actually. And so thank you very much. And thank you for those kind words of introduction. So, what I'm going to do is really share with you a spectrum of my work in India and share with you, I think, what sort of Brett described as this completely crazy condition with many, many things happening simultaneously. And I think designers, architects, planners are dealing there with an entire gamut of social, cultural, economic, sort of transitions that are molding the built environment phenomenally rapidly, but also in a kind of schizophrenic way. And I think the role of the architect is actually you're getting marginalized as professionals in this condition, because within conventional praxis or building-centric praxis, the professional does not engage in a sense with this broader landscape that is emerging. And so for us, our approach of working in Mumbai, it's an approach where the city has really, and the city and its region have acted as a laboratory from which we've sort of nourished our practice, or prioritized, in a sense, the issues that we want to deal with. So I'm going to divide this lecture into two parts. I'm going to share my research work and my readings, but which will also lead to the formulation of the nature of the practice, because I think to make practice and our professional engagements elastic is, I think, what the Indian case sort of, I think, potentially could teach us. So Mumbai, which is where we are sort of we are based, and I think the city is—it's a landscape which is really about negotiating global flows, because in a condition like this, in the mutinous democracy of India, global flows don't erase the local, but they remake the landscape in interesting ways, and I think that's what throws up these startling adjacencies. Some practitioners refer to this as the informal city. I think that's an unproductive category because I think the binary between the formal and the informal city is not something that's useful for designers to intervene and act in. It sets up a binary and it forces you to declare your alliances with one or the other. And so for me, my work has really been about seeing how one can blur that. And I construct a third space, which is called the kinetic city, which I think is very particular to the urbanism of Mumbai. And I'm going to sort of take you through some observations to share with you what I mean by this. And so the practice has really been organized around a series of issues. We've sort of used research very mindfully as a sort of also as an identity forming process in an introspective sense, because I think looking at other cultures is one thing, but also looking at multiple cultures within your locality is I think really interesting. And so research has been fundamental or central to the practice. And then we've looked at a series of issues which I'll sort of touch upon as I go through this. So research, but research also as advocacy. And these are some of the publications we've produced as part of the firm, which sort of range from looking at the city more particularly, looking at aspects that we've used to facilitate the conversation about historic preservation, sometimes just archiving and documentation, because when I started my practice, I was appalled to see that there was really no material that spoke to designers that existed in terms of looking at urban history, looking at processes of buildings historically. And then to be operating in a place like this, which is explosive in the way it grows, and with this sharp growth, I think it produces a particular kind of culture, which is, of course, characterized by inequity, but it also it forces you to imagine the city as an elastic condition. So in this condition, when you have growth that's sort of adding a few million people every decade, the city is not about grand vision, it's about grand adjustment. I mean, that really becomes the challenge more than sort of panning out. And of course, it's also a very particular landscape, say, compared to the South American case, where the favelas and the formal city, so to speak, exist in differentiated space. Here, the blur, the interweaving of these worlds, which sort of coexist in a healthy tension of a simultaneous play of rejection and affinity, is a very, very particular condition. And this is the kinetic condition that I'm talking about, where in physical space, they begin to coexist. And of course, it sets up these crazy inequities, which are bizarre, and how one resolves them becomes a challenge. But the kinetic city is really, to me, characterized by these three conditions, which is one of elasticity, the other, which is incrementalism, and appropriation of space. And Mumbai, like several cities in India and perhaps around the world in this post-industrial scenario, has resulted in a new system of fragmentation of services, production locations, etc., and it's resulted in a kind of bazaar-like urbanism, which has woven its presence right through the landscape. And it's an urbanism created by those outside the elite domain of the formal modernity of the state. And it's what Ravi Sundaram refers to as a pirate modernity that slips under the laws of the city to simply survive without any conscious attempt at constructing a counterculture. And this phenomena is critical to the city being connected to the global economy. However, the spaces that it creates have been largely excluded from the cultural discourse and globalization, which invariably focus on elite domains of production in the city. So it's not the city of the poor or the regular models of the formal and informal and other such binaries that are used to explain cities in Africa, America, South America, and India, but it's a kinetic space, a space where these models collapse into singular entities in space where these meanings are ever shifting and blurred. And it is to this space, the space of the kinetic city, that I believe we should be focusing our attention. And for me, for my research, this has been very central. And the question, of course, this raises is, can we design for these spaces as architects, as conservationists, urban designers, planners? Can we design with a divided mind? And so the kinetic city is not perceived by architecture or cohesive urban design gestures, but by spaces which hold associative values and are supportive of lives. Patterns of occupation determine their form and their perception. It's a sort of indigenous urbanism that has a particular local logic, and again, it's not necessarily the city of the poor, but it is rather, it's a temporal articulation and occupation of space which not only creates a richer sensibility of spatial occupation, but also suggests how spatial limits are expanded to include formerly unimagined uses in dense urban conditions. And so this is a wonderful diagram that's called the five stages of squatting, which is how the city is made over a year. You know, when, by the time summer comes, they put a canopy. By the monsoon, they fortify themselves. Everyone is sympathetic, but then they're part of the landscape. And the entire city is made by these incremental moves. Again, the image is the third stage of squatting. And of course, as a result of this density, you have new imaginations that come to bear. And this is to scale open space in Mumbai. And even to Delhi, you can see the difference. It's just absolutely extreme. And of course, people then innovate in terms of this elastic condition. And for example, even the fragmentation of space, the consolidation of the same space, say, in New York or in London or even in Delhi, doesn't occur. And so, for example, this is a great example where the cricket fields, you know, this beautiful Indian game that the British invented. It's sort of, these spaces exist all over the city, and they get occupied in the winter wedding season by weddings. And you see the pitch is not touched because that's really sacred. And the club members take tea and they get samosas from the same kitchen that is feeding the wedding. But these sort of occur on 8-hour cycles. They get set up at about noon after the cricketers are finished. And by the morning, they disappear and they're back at cricket. And so this sort of elasticity in the city, I think, is an important sort of aspect. It's cultural. Now, this is the very rich using the city in the same temporal articulation. So therefore, the kinetic city as a phenomena or as a condition is not one that is only the city of the poor. And I think this is something that's very important. Or at festival times, this beautiful street gets converted for 10 days into an auditorium by the addition of this temporary gateway. And a lot is invested in making this. It's just in paper mache, so it's not expensive. But it's a new articulation and sensibility. And there's an auditorium there. They show Bollywood films there. Or in preservation, it gets taken to an interesting extreme where meanings are shifting. So this is a grade one building. It was the town hall that the British built. It's the only classical building in Mumbai. And now our governor, on Independence Day, goes to speak to the citizens here as the British governor did. But now our Independence Day is on the 15th of August in the middle of the monsoon, so the Public Works Department is charged with taking the governor up these steps without getting him wet. And you know, a 5-star hotel would have got 2 strapping Sikh guys with umbrellas and bugles and they would have marched up. But the Public Works Department has other ideas. So what they do is they wrap the building up. And they take the governor up there. And it happens every year. The conservationists and the preservationists in the city go berserk. They all write letters to the editor. I mean, this is something we inherited from the British as a powerful instrument of protest. And so they're letters to the editor, the preservation. But actually, this is okay. This is a kinetic moment where meanings are altered. By UNESCO standards, this is acceptable because it's reversible. It disappears in a few hours. There are no nails that are used. There are just coir ropes that are wrapped around it. But what it does is also powerful because it subverts a colonial icon for our purpose. So it makes the condition again elastic. And of course, it's decorated with flowers. It's very beautiful. But it's appropriated And I mean, when we talk about sustainability, it's a mode of recycling spatial programmatic sort of content off the building. And in the morning, it's back to normal. So I think this notion of the kinetic city, for me as a designer, is much more productive because it blurs these boundaries, it collapses these models, and it allows an elasticity, which I think resonates at many levels because in our urban condition, whether it's Europe now and extreme conditions in places like India, urban flux is going to be something we're going to have to deal with, and how we can come up with holding strategies, and also relevant for emergency housing, for refugee camps, all of that. So I think it's worth us as designers looking at these other narratives of urbanism outside this sort of simplistic binary of the formal and the informal city. And of course, when there are many, many examples which I'll run you through very, very quickly, because you know, this is, for example, entrepreneurship. It completely falls. This is the dabbawalas who deliver lunch boxes, and they use a formal infrastructure of the Mumbai railways, which is very efficient, and an informal economy which folds into each other, leverages their own sort of resources to use this network to deliver lunch at €3 or £3, or, well, pounds would be a little more, but it would be €3 a month. They deliver 200,000 boxes with a 1 million error and take your lunch from your house to your office and back for that amount. And they use the railway system to leverage this. So they collect it at suburban locations, they create a relay system, they get it down to your desk at your office, and then they take it back all for that. And it's an informal economy. And that's where the formal and the informal is an economic definition, which is where it should reside. I think for design and planning, we need to construct a new narrative. But this is an example where it collapses. Or Procter Gamble, with Prahlad, who wrote this book about the bottom of the pyramid, they discovered the biggest markets at the bottom of the pyramid, and Procter Gamble just invented the sachet, which makes beautiful popular visual culture because it sort of makes these glistening separations between hawkers. But essentially what they did was they broke the product down into increments. So a shampoo bottle, which a worker would need a whole month's salary to buy to wash after a construction site, would never be able to afford it because a month's salary getting locked into a luxury. But by having a sachet, it gives them the flexibility for a few cents to buy it when they need. So it opens up massive. So this notion of incrementalism, I don't think it hasn't been embedded in our narratives of planning and architecture adequately. Or McDonald's, who do home delivery in Mumbai. I mean, the drive-in idea is not possible in Mumbai, so they've opened up a massive market by doing home delivery. Now, this is a corporation that has inverted its bases, in a sense, to make viable in another context, another geography, its own efficiency. And so what can one learn from that? So in the kinetic city, which is bazaar-like in its form, and can be seen as this sort of symbolic image of the emerging urban Indian landscape. Also, architecture is not the central spectacle of the city, and I think this is a very important part. It begins to challenge architecture as the spectacle of the city. Processions, weddings, festivals, hawkers, street vendors, slum dwellers all create an ever-transforming streetscape. And here, festivals such as, you know, there are many, many festivals, I don't even name them, but Muharram, Durga Puja, or Ganesh, which in Mumbai is a big one. 5 million people participate in this for 10 days. The entire city transforms, and that auditorium is set up in those 10 days for the Ganesh festival, and you can see how the street's been covered to create an auditorium. Again, this sort of elasticity of this condition. And you know, they have lights, it's all temporal for 10 days. And then on the last day, millions of people immerse the Ganesh idol, which is made in clay, in the sea. And here immersion becomes a metaphor for the spectacle of the city. As the clay idol dissolves in the water of the bay, the spectacle comes to a close. There are no static or permanent mechanisms to encode this spectacle. Here the memory of the city is an enacted process, a temporal moment as opposed to buildings that contain the public memory as static or permanent entities. The city and its architecture then don't necessarily mean the same thing. They cannot be contained in a single meaning. Within the kinetic city, meanings are not stable. Spaces get consumed, reinterpreted, recycled in really healthy ways. And the kinetic city often appropriates the image of the static city to create these new spectacles. And I think this synergy is what I think makes the argument very interesting in ways we could take this further. As opposed to architecture, which is only the only spectacle of the city. And I think this is important. I call this the landscape of impatient capital, because I think the impatience of capital has forced many territories to focus not on civil society, but to create terrains where this capital can land uncontested and realize itself very quickly. Dubai, Singapore, Shanghai are exactly built on this sort of narrative. And then architects, and my friend Farshid here is doing this interesting book, which is precisely mapping the constraints within which are the typologies that emerge from this sort of phenomena, where I think architects are then restricted to curving and twisting their buildings within parameters that don't actually begin to address other issues. So I think this is the other extreme to the kinetic city, where the kinetic city is more human-centric. And my argument is not that the solution is the kinetic city. My argument is that I think that needs to be another narrative which could, I think, in productive and constructive ways, inform or moderate the other extreme of these sort of landscapes of impatient capital. And I think that becomes an interesting question, at least for me. And of course, with housing, it's a very complicated question, and I know there's a housing lab here, but you know, I mean, I think I'm not sure what the answer is, but I think essentially housing forces us to look at the problem and not forget that architecture is also about speculation, and it's about how one can bring to bear ways that infrastructure, mobility, all of that can be reorchestrated to solve these problems. Because the solution of slums, the solutions of Dharavi in Mumbai don't lie in Dharavi. They lie in the imagination we can bring to bear in terms of how regions are orchestrated. And I was very pleased to see today here the studio that's looking at the Mumbai-Delhi corridor, which throws up these incredible questions. Because otherwise, impatient capital is bullying us to making decisions to remake our cities in one image, which is what has happened in China. Every city has been remade in an image. Of course, there are nuanced differences. I'm just exaggerating this to make the point. And then, of course, with that comes a detachment and a particular kind of phenomena of gated communities and the extreme that we all have to live with. And really, you know, if you look at the history of questions of squatter settlements and slums, it was characterized in the 60s and the 50s by denial, followed by eradication in the next decade, tolerance by the 80s as political regimes changed, improvement in the 90s in slum upgradation and things. And of course, it means anticipation is what we really need to. So it really is about reorchestrating. And the speculative aspect of it, I think, is something we have to, it becomes even more urgent in the condition that I'm sort of describing of how infrastructure can be orchestrated in order to do this. Essentially, to borrow Clifford Geertz, who's a social anthropologist, he used the word agricultural involution when he talked about Indonesian rice farmers who did multi-cropping to make their fields very efficient. And they became incredibly productive, but they became internally so complex that they were susceptible to malfunction. And I think urban involution is what's happening in Mumbai, where places like Dharavi, we celebrate for their productive values, for the amount of space they use, the human resource they sort of engage with. But these are highly susceptible to malfunction, whether it's questions of sanitation, ill health, or riots and social unrest, etc. So I don't think we can fool ourselves about that, because this balance between involutionary and evolutionary processes, which is looking at regional and broader imagination, speculating about how one can diversify into other modes, is something we shouldn't forget about. And I'm putting that up there because I'm not proposing the of the kinetic city, or at least in my learning, as the solution, rather one more narrative that that enriches this process. And of course, in our studios, we all do this, and I'm not going to get into this, but I think this is central, at least at my work at the GSD, in bringing back the debate for places like Mumbai and India, the questions of these regional imaginations, which throw up many other networked possibilities which today's world demands. And so, as an extension of that, one of the projects we're working on is at the GSD is the Kumbh Mela project, which is this incredible festival that occurs every 12 years, and we've just come back from there. We were 40 students with 5 faculty members who live there, and we've called it Mapping the Ephemeral Megacity, because it's only been mapped in terms of the spectacle of the sadhus who are there, etc. But it's an amazing, amazing example of, I'm taking the idea of the kinetic or the temporal to almost a mind-boggling extreme, because this is a city that's set up. It's an interdisciplinary project with the 5 schools at the university, including the School of Religion, Public Health, who are spending 55 days there. We only spent a week or 10 days, but it involves 30 million pilgrims, more maybe. It lasts for 55 days, and an entire city is set up. And of course, religion is what's fundamental to it. So there's a kind of raison d'etre for it happening, which of course explains some of its efficiencies and things. But it's set on the banks of the river Ganga and the Yamuna, where they intersect. Until October, this happens in January. They don't even know what the terrain will be, and they have 6 weeks to set up a megacity where 3 or 4 million people reside permanently for 55 days, and the fluxes go up by 10 and 15 million people on the bathing day. So it's a mind-boggling operation, and that's the memory of the grid on Google from 12 years ago, and that's what it looks like, and it extends 10 kilometers up north. So the scale of this is absolutely mind-boggling. And these are images I took in July when the water hadn't yet receded. And that's the same image from a week ago by my iPhone. That's why it's got bad resolution. But it's settled. It's an entire settlement. It has 10,000 employees that run it. There's a commissioner who's in charge of the city. There are 2 hospitals, 17 clinics. I mean, it's a complete city. And it goes up to the horizon in that image. That's the extent of it. I mean, it's a massive management a problem. But it's an incredible model of public-private. It's actually a model of how you can set up a temporal city, and we're just beginning our research, so I can't share. I mean, I don't have enough well-articulated to share with you, but each of those blocks are given to communities who self-organize themselves versus a refugee camp. And this refugee camp in Kenya has been around for 20 years. It's got 460,000 people, and it's just an aggregation of single units where identities are completely dissolved, whereas in the Kumbh Mela, identities are reinforced by giving communities sectors. So, I mean, there are many, many embedded lessons here, including how social infrastructure is deployed in this place that could be very, very, I mean, could be very useful for us imagining questions of risks or climate change and disaster. And so that sort of, for me, one of the interesting things of my experience there was, you know, I would bet, and I don't know the statistics on this, we are talking to cell phone companies to get their database to be able to predict where people came from, and we're working on it, and hopefully in 6 months we'll have something out. But my gut there was that about, of the 10 or 15 or 20 million people, about 1% would be from the megacities. Most people coming there, 95% at least, would be from little villages in the small towns. And so those towns are actually being made like this temporary city is being made. And this is the urban time bomb that India is sitting on, which we don't recognize. Because all of us, whether it's through our pedagogy and studios at the AA, or, I mean, I was just talking to Brett about other places, and I was happy to hear they're looking at Trivandrum and, you know, other cities which are smaller. But 7 megacities is where we are all focusing our energies. And these are highly contested. Architects can't intervene there. It's too complex. And yet all our energies, about 20 schools a year, come and do a studio in Dharavi. I mean, for me, that's like the biggest waste of human energy. And so the 28 tier 2 towns, yes, you can intervene. The 393, let's say 100,000 people town, are going to become 1 million people in 20 years. So 400 million Indians are going to reside in places we don't even know the names of today. And the Kumbh Mela project for us is a way of understanding how one could apply principles, because those are the people that use this city temporarily for 55 days, but with great efficiency. So this is how it folds back. But what this does for me, and this is when I go into my projects, is it also tells us that we are going to be challenged by new models of engagement in terms of practice. Because, so what you see here in orange is what I call the architectural spine of awareness in India, Chandigarh, and where modernism managed to percolate. So it's Chandigarh, Delhi, Ahmedabad, Baroda, Mumbai, Goa, because of the things Charles Correa did there, Pondicherry, because you had communities living there. But that's the axis of modernism, which carries a particular model of engagement in terms of building, which is an extension of the kind of modernist training, the aesthetic, and all of that. Now what you have is an explosion of those southern cities you see in blue. And you can see how the explosion of the small towns are going to align with each of these axes. The whole parameter for building, the sensibility, the traditions are completely different. The problems are going to be completely different in those zones. And I think what's interesting for me are two things. One is that India is going through 2 simultaneous transitions, like so is East Europe and other places, where we are transitioning out of socialism and transitioning into capitalism. And these are happening simultaneously, and they'll probably run for many decades simultaneously. It's not a neat transition from one into the other. And this manifests itself in the built environment in very, very powerful ways. And part of the schizophrenia you see in cities there is because these dynamics are simultaneously occurring. The other, which I think is very important, is in a place like India, Turkey, many parts of, you know, maybe Africa too, aesthetic modernity arrived way before social modernity, and there's a complete disjuncture there. Because you had, because of Chandigarh, because of modernism, young generation then in the 60s of charismatic architects. Modernism was sort of embraced by the country, but without the project of social modernity being put into place. So this disjuncture when you go to India and you see buildings badly used and there's a complete mismatch between, you know, facade transformations, people who occupy them, comes from this. So this, I think, gets exaggerated as a question when you look at this new emerging landscape. And so models of practice, I think, then become a really critical question. And I think this new piece of research, the book on architecture that I did, is precisely looking at this question of what are the different models by which architects can begin to. And these models, when I say models of practice, they mean completely different protocols. On one end, protocols that range from being able to email tender drawings and having a process and having a very skilled set of vendors who can construct your buildings, to the other extreme where there are already rules written in the tradition by which buildings are made. And the biggest buildings in India are made not by the first, which I call the global practice, but by the counter-modernism. And these are the biggest investments in projects, and they don't involve any architects. So it's a real critique on the profession that we haven't had the ability to engage with the landscape that is actually being invested in the most right now in the city. And I don't know what that means, but I think what this does for the world is really throws up a broader question, one of pluralism and how it can be manifest in the built environment, and is that a viable project or not? And I think that is a meta sort of question there. And I think we've been lucky, a lot of our projects in the South, which I'm going to now run you through. So building ecology, for me, has been an important sort of issue, and one has looked at it here through our conservation work in the broadest sense, because I think our preservation work has made us understand how people, traditions, histories, building materials all begin to create synergies. And then one has tried to extend that into our more contemporary work. And so measure drawings has been very much part of the practice. We've done hundreds of drawings for different historic buildings, which we've documented, not been published, but we've documented and have portfolios. And we've also been involved in restoration. This is the Chaumala Palace in Hyderabad, which belonged to the Nizam. And it was partly a reconstruction project, understanding materials, in this case, lime, which takes 3 months to build on a granite structure, gives you a whole different sense of time, of technology. And this is the restored version where kilns were set up on the site. That entire ceiling is a new, they have great craftsmanship. So one had the opportunity to also engage with other protocols in terms of processes of making. And so I think a lot of the learning, which is sort of represented in the book, comes from the spectrum of engagement. And so when we talk about the kinetic city, I think the question that it also throws up for the profession and for pedagogy as a massive challenge is how can we equip students also to work with that elasticity, to be able to slide sideways through different forms of protocol simultaneously? Or is that doable? That's why I ask, can we design with a divided mind, or can the protocols be separate from that, which makes us more effective in the way we can embed our operations and intervene in the city? And of course, we've converted this into a museum on the legacy of the Nizam, beautiful fabrics, which were also, this was a large restoration project that ran for 10 years, and we worked on it simultaneously. And then this sort of lesser known building was one we got sort of involved with, and we were asked to do a master plan for this. And I think for me, what was important within this context of building ecology is what are the narratives by which we even affect our efforts in the preservation debate. And I think these are highly flawed, and they're not elastic, again, enough in ways to incorporate people. And so all the narratives by which the Archaeological Survey of India was restoring the Taj was, UNESCO, this, that, which was centric on building materials, but it ignored completely the ecology that built this. And so how does one sort of then develop these multiple narratives, which become, I think, very productive, because, identity is not static. I think we make this terrible mistake of trying to find identity. Identity is constructed, so it's a speculative project. In the same way, preservation is about constructing significance, incorporating contemporary practices, incorporating contemporary sensibilities, but within limits of the integrity of the building. And so for us, this became really important. And a small thing, for example, the Taj, the focus is that garden with the white monument. But the origins of the Taj go from here to the end of the slide. It is a four-part sort of design, one where the craftsmen lived. There were four hexagonal structures there, the forecourt, the main garden, the monument, and then the Mehtab Bagh, which is a garden across. And for those of us who grew up in India, we learned that there was supposed to be a black Taj there, which was, of course, false, because what it was, which has been excavated, Liz Moynihan actually excavated it, is a reflecting pool where the emperor on a moonlit night went and saw the reflection of the Taj, and poetry was composed. And so this poetry of a reflection in murky water gave rise to the legend of the black Taj. But the assembler, as a complete sort of design proposition, never found its way into the conservation debate because people were monument centric. And so we began to identify, so this is what we call the aesthetic tourist. And so people, the Taj has become a one-liner. I mean, once you've got that photograph, you're actually almost ready to go. And so how does one build these narratives? Because Agra is in terrible state. It's a dying city. And if Agra dies, the Taj dies. And so how do you get more hotel room nights? How do you create a broader ecology? And I think, I'm not going to get into all those planning questions, but the fundamental question is, how do you build more narratives by which you can nuance the readings of the Taj in interesting ways? And so we looked at this, and in our studies, we realized, we worked on this for 5 years, so these were long site management projects with many folks involved. And I realized that Mathura, which is a Hindu city, a lot of the tourists who come there are not the aesthetic tourists. They're the smallest group. But all our policies are geared to the aesthetic tourists, usually Western. Whereas these pilgrims are from Mathura. They go to a very holy Hindu site. And what moved me was when they went into the tomb of Mumtaz Mahal, the empress, they made a sign of reverence as they touched the tomb. And that is really revealing, because the sacred then goes beyond religion that we try to use as a polarizing mechanism in our politics. And so we began to start widening our imagination in terms of the constituency that could be engaged to enjoy the Taj Mahal. And that became part of it. And you know, on every Friday, the Taj is closed. It's yet actively used as a mosque. This is a World Heritage Site which is used as a mosque, so you're not allowed to go in there except if you're Muslim or live there. So this is, in a way, even an active kind of thing. So, I mean, these are constituencies that are ignored when we build these narratives about preservation. And so when we looked at the statistics, it was 0.3 million were the foreign tourists. So we began to say, what would be the narratives that we could articulate that might make it exciting for these constituencies, which would build up, So we had Bernard Fielden, who died 3 years ago, Sir Bernard Fielden, who was part of our working group, and we worked on this, like I said, for 5 years. So decisions were very carefully made. It wasn't like we were just sort of making up something, and we broke it into many project components, and of course there was conservation work, some very difficult moves that had to be made. And then we concentrated on creating these visitor centers where interpretation and all of this could happen. Again, I won't get into the, but just to give you, they were restored, so this was a restoration project we did. And, you know, it's been 7 years. This is not even used today. The government found this whole proposition very complicated. And if we have time at the end, I can get into this, because this is a very important political question. We did signage. None of this has been implemented. But what we focused on was the craftsmen who made this, because what we noticed was that every piece of stone in the Taj complex has a signature of the craftsmen who made it. They're either symbols, as you can see on the paving on the ground, or on the main elements, they write their full names, because they really did very elaborate work. And this was an interesting story that we sort of, with Eba Kochwi, and that's Lahori, who's considered to be the architect, but she was one of the members of our working group, she interpreted the symbols. And you know, the Mughal said the sound of chiseling of stone was the sound of a live city. And how does one sort of bring that back and celebrate those people? And the other component that was important, and again, this is just to tell you how these narratives enriched the process, was the question of the garden. That's a drawing by Eba Koch also, that's a historic map. In Mughal legislation, you could not inherit land. The only way a family could keep hold of land was to convert it into a funerary site, because then it became a garden, and they could tend the garden, and they used it as a pleasure garden. So it was a subversive strategy to hold land, which landed up in Agra being one of the most beautiful waterfront cities in the world in the 1600s, because everyone converted their sites into funerary sites. That's why the most beautiful mosques, however small they are, there. And the Taj was one such one, which the emperor sort of decided to build. Now, the garden, therefore, was very, very important, and you can see they were all waterfront gardens all along the river. That's why in this stretch, the Yamuna hasn't changed course. The Ganga and the Yamuna are very dynamic rivers, but they haven't changed course here. Now, this is what happened. Now, this garden, by which we all know the Taj Mahal, And the authenticity of this, and this is why the government got nervous with our proposal, was actually a garden that Lord Curzon created, because the regiment band in Agra and the cantonment of Agra had great pride in its performance sort of skills. And they requested the governor that they would want to perform every day on the plinth of the Taj Mahal, and that the English women and children could sit and picnic and hear them perform every evening. So what Curzon did was he ordered the cutting of the garden, which has altered the fundamental design intention of the Taj Mahal, which is not torn. Now, this is a powerful narrative. So this is what it was. And this is a picture when the orchard was unkept. The design intention of the Taj, and that's why it's white and taut, was it was supposed to be this monument to love, but I believe it was more than that. It was the emperor modeling a piece of heaven on earth. And it was white because it was supposed to feel like it floated in paradise garden. And the emperor had fruit trees. The hardier trees were on the edges. The delicate trees were near the water, so they would get sprinkled. And he would choose what trees he wanted. We did paleobotany tests to ascertain the species. And he would smell mangoes as he would walk around. But it was his experience of being in paradise garden. And so this fundamental design intention has been brutally altered by that one intervention, which has now become the authentic image of the Taj. So this is really complicated. And I think the moment you start using these other lenses to discern what might be these narratives, what are these significances, it becomes a really complicated question. And that's an image which captures what that intention was. This is in fog, but you can imagine that you walked into Paradise Garden and you saw this thing floating there, which is what his design intention was. It was supposed to be a garden in eternal bloom, and these college kids, I think, understood that and had a friend photograph them. But it was supposed to symbolize a garden in eternal bloom, and that's the beauty of the metaphor of using the Paradise Garden with the monument, etc. Complete alteration. And of course, we reconstructed it and things, but I think we were. So from some points, you kind of get this glimpse even today where the trees have survived. And so I think the Taj, this monument of love, I think its significance will evolve. It'll be interpreted through different lenses in different ways. But I think my point is that significance is a dynamic process. And then in post-colonial conditions, it becomes even more complicated, because when the custodians of an environment and the creators of the environment are two different cultures in post-colonial situations, like in Mumbai, it becomes even more complicated. And this is, you know, the statues, the British statues, which were in beautiful public places, were in the 70s when we renamed Bombay Mumbai. They moved them. Now they line the compound wall of the Bombay Zoo. And it's unfortunate, because these are really beautiful statues. And so when we were engaged with conservation, we were part of a project that got the first heritage regulations in Bombay in 95. We were confronted with this idea, is what is the significance that you discern? And we sort of moved the narrative into this idea of constructing significance while keeping the buildings intact. And we invented districts with festivals. We whitewashed buildings. We just sort of, with little interventions, animated public space there, but it created a new significance for the place, and now it's called the Art District, and the money has actually gone into restoring everything. So the contemporary engines that drive the process of conservation, I think, are linked very much to the kind of narratives that we can sensitively construct. And I think, like identity formation, significance is also about construction, and it changes with every generation. So we got the Grade 1 buildings restored. We did a whole lot of things which would have not been possible if we were worrying about what English heritage said about Bombay's significance according to their narratives, where they were the creators of that environment. We are the custodians, and I think this is also speculative in a sense, but I think this is the role of the architect. And then, of course, that leads us to architecture, because we made many interventions there, including this little pavilion, which we've done recently in this Grade 1 precinct, because it starts, these new narratives also make space for architecture. The old narratives in the way they solidify places also are limiting in terms of architectural intervention. And so I think the space for architecture comes by this synergy, by the construction of these narratives, and then the new crafts that you can demonstrate in places like this. And that now leads me to my projects, which is, one concern has been softening thresholds, because I believe in our polarized sort of environments, thresholds get very harsh in terms of the way architecture hardens thresholds between economic groups. And for example, this house outside Mumbai, I met the contractor and asked him who the architect was, and he said, no, I designed it. So I said, maybe you designed it? He said, yeah, they just gave me a photograph of the White House in Washington and I designed it. And so, so you begin to start having villas like this on the outskirts of cities, where with the rural landscape, there are amazing polarizations that occur. And I believe architecture can play a role in dissipating this. So, as a proposal, I mean, we built this. This is a house for a young filmmaker and his wife. And what we convinced them to do was to, for example, build the house as a pavilion. And their living room is that pavilion, which when they go away on the weekends, because they hardly come there once or twice a month, it becomes something that the villagers can occupy. And the caretaker sits there with his family, his kids study there. I've even seen a wedding happen there once. And it becomes a gesture of generosity. And of course, as the place gets filled in and there are more houses, maybe that'll change. But I mean, I think in our spatial imagination, if we begin to fold in or identify challenges where the social is also material in architecture, especially in polarized conditions like our ever-transforming cities, I think architecture can play a significant role. And it's not that you compromise how you might articulate this as a weekend house you would do otherwise. So you can invest, this was done now 13 years ago, but you can invest in the architectural moves and, you know, all of that. But you can also, I think, embed aspirations such as this. And this is other house, which is on the poster. We created a series of thresholds which are within the house here, outside the house. So the farmers can come and meet the owners of the house there, transact, be offered a cup of tea without necessarily compromising the privacy of the clients who are urban people who want their own sophisticated environment with a lap pool. So how you soften these thresholds by accommodating rather than creating. So creating spatial or privacy gradients that are softer and not abrupt, I think becomes a way that you begin to create this engagement between polarized sections of society, different economic groups. So this house we did in a tea plantation, our first thing was to convince the client not to cut the tea and to leave the tea. Of course, they wanted waterfalls and boulders and stuff, and we said no. And we then worked with this idea of subverting even the identity of what might be a weekend house. So my greatest success was when I went then, I asked for directions to the house, and someone said, oh, you mean the tea factory house? It's there. And so it's associated as a tea factory. But what it does, I mean, besides, of course, making the right moves or touching the ground very lightly, you know, and articulating it architecturally as moments and light and craftsmanship that we've used, materials. I mean, all the things that, you know, I don't want to spend time talking about, framing of views. It allows this kind of transparency between the tea picker and people who might be having breakfast on the veranda. For me, I think that becomes very important rather than this being something that's exclusive that people working there can't even access visually. And I think these are little moves that can help architecture sort of, and then crafting traditions. I mean, you know, when we talk about India, traditions always sort of show up. And I have great problems with the way I think some of these traditional crafts are being fetishized. We use a lot of them, but I think what's happening is this sort of this fetishizing is part of of evoking local specificity, which I think is not even valid, because I think that anxiety that globalization results in homogeneity and that we have to critique it by fetishizing the local, I think is a 2-decade-old problem. And I think we are now networked in much more complex ways, where I think the confidence of local identities, or whatever you might call it, our local specificity is what I prefer to call it, I think embeds itself in the architecture through more rigorous analysis of whether it's climate or other things. And I think this is a really important question. And I think, you know, now you're beginning to have American architects, for example, building in Africa and building in other places. And I think it's becoming a complicated question of what are the images that you're evoking versus, I mean, I would think as a local practitioner, I would think the other way, and I'll just demonstrate it through some projects. And for me, this carpenter's box is wonderful because castrol, heavy-duty oil, sort of resides with the pantheon of gods. And, you know, I mean, I think this sort of coming together is about that aspiration. And of course, the monsoon, which is threatening, is a climatic input, and how you respond through making in another climate is an interesting question. This sort of thing that we have to all be cautious about, where we have moved away from looking at weathering to weatherproofing, is another question which has, I think, great implications on the whole debate about LEEDs and LEED certification and sustainability. And then I think from conservation, just to loop back, I think the life cycle of materials is what we really learned, of how you can create contemporary expression, but embedding all those lessons of this broader building ecology question that one sort of engages with firsthand in preservation projects. And this last question of the local and global is an interesting one, and I'm going to just show you 6 projects really quickly to end it on this last theme. Which is, you know, I mean, for me, the challenge is how do you localize global programs? Because global programs are fancy, I mean, they're put loose, in a sense. And the question of how you can make capital more patient by embedding it in a place and localizing it is critical. And I don't think the answer is craft. I don't think the answer is aesthetics even. But I think it has to be a deeper excavation of the site and one's own understanding of the problems. And I think the inverse is true for local programs. Because local programs, we can't fetishize by making them caricatures of what might be the vernacular or what might be X, Y, and Z. But I think those aspirations of local programs that grow out of the problems of a place are what can resonate very powerfully globally. And how one can globalize these in terms of the lessons, to give the lessons agency to resonate more broadly, I think is a real challenge. And I think for us in the contemporary world, because we are all interconnected in complex ways, communities are much more complex than just physical communities, I think this becomes an interesting question. And I think for architects to engage in resisting global programs from being autonomous, being impatient, and local programs from becoming caricatures, I think is the problem of the future. And so this was our first project in 1995, which was for a machine tool company. These are global projects. It's a corporate headquarters for a machine tool company. We had just started our practice, and we were given that as a brief. They had a company in Australia who was going to get them the curtain glazing because they had the licenses. We were just liberalizing our economy. And then, of course, we challenged that, and we talked about the context, the physicality, cooling the building passively, and it resulted in a completely different solution, which is a series. Also, internalizing the ostentation of the building rather than externalizing it, which is what glass does, but also softening those thresholds in ways people, ordinary people, can actually penetrate a building like that. So that's what the organization, and you kind of go through the building, you know, from the street. It's much lower slung than what a tower would have been, but you can also see right through the building through a series of courtyards where water is recycled and reused, and the green becomes sort of telescopic in the way the courtyards sort of stack up visually. And then, of course, we had a one-room deep office with circulation spaces that were well-lit, airy, that became places to meet. Artists were involved in the in building elements, so to speak. And the scale of the building changed as you went into the more private offices. This is Manjeet Bawa, who took his figures, which he only had done as two dimensions, and converted them into railings for us. And all over the building, we recycled the granite for the waterfall, and an artist sort of worked out the lotus, which is a symbol of Lakshmi, because the name of the company is Lakshmi Machine Works, where 104 Lakshmis were installed in this piece by an artist, which is a flag, but in stainless steel. And then we, because it's a naturally ventilated building, we went into the machine tool yard, and we picked up all their scrap machine, scrap waste, and with Yogesh Rawal, evolved, based on the old Jali, the Mughal Jali, which is about filtering light and air, we worked out a pattern of 34 or 35 screens, which can be cleaned, they can be removed, they can be altered to become more dense, but they create a motif from the scrap material of the machine tool company. So I think it began to give this new corporation that has had aspirations of attracting global capital, manifesting itself in the image that it felt would be receptive to the West, to kind of, I think, have the confidence to create another aesthetic which came out of what might be local resources, the logic of climate, but also just simply using scrap metal like this in beautiful ways. The second project, and this is not the project, this is a typical IT building in Jaipur. And Jaipur is about 50 degrees in the summer, so you can actually fry an egg on the road. It's so hot, so you can imagine what happens in this building in terms of air conditioning. And we were asked by Hewlett Packard to design their campus in Bangalore, where Infosys and all of those are IT buildings, which are essentially glass boxes. And in studying some of the existing buildings, the three buildings at the base here, I won't name the architect, but he's an AA graduate, were also glass box. He might have done one of these short courses or something. Yeah. Brett, I'll tell you his name later. They were really glass boxes. And in analyzing it, we found that actually, except what's yellow, where the software stuff actually happens, nothing else in Bangalore needed to be even air-conditioned. And this is where I think we ran into the whole LEED problem, because in trying to get a certificate for our American client, because they were hell-bent on getting a LEED certificate, we got negatives on every aspect of our design. And one realized this incredible hegemony of the US codes when it comes to the whole debate of sustainability, because somewhere, you know, the British architects in the 50s and 60s, Jane Drew, and the whole lot of them in Africa, did wonderful buildings with passive cooling, which was linked to the funding that was going back to the colonies and that whole politic. But somewhere in the 80s, the high-techs hijacked the whole debate of sustainability, and it became a chemical and mechanical fix to a problem. So it wasn't going to the fundamentals of the problem, but it was chemically or mechanically fixing it, either through sealants or through, you know, better efficient fans that could move air quickly, etc. So what we finally did here was 200 square feet per ton of air conditioning is what's considered business as usual in India. 290, they were willing to give us a certificate. We achieved 705 square feet per ton, not by mechanical or chemical fixes, but by just not air conditioning 50% of the space. And if it's not air conditioned, it doesn't even count in the LEED equation. But for the client, it made a huge difference. So, I mean, how, again, you pose this narrative about what sustainability is, I mean, is culturally specific, climatically specific, and I think also needs to be challenged. So for me, localizing the problem, these might be instruments by which you can do that. It's not only an aesthetic question. But by doing that, it opened up many possibilities, because we created this street with all the amenities which you showed in, which you saw in color in the previous plan. They were all strung along a street, which made it a very social space, because these young people otherwise are isolated in their own box and they don't meet each other. There were food courts on either end, and the software blocks were shaded with trees. We sort of used the existing trees there. But I think we got a more interesting architecture in the process, much better modulation of space and light and ventilation, and a happier place for these younger people who, after being in for 6 and 8 hours on their computers, at their computer screen, at least their senses could come alive with natural air, light, smells, etc. And of course, there's a great range of spaces. The food courts are completely naturally ventilated and become really social spaces in the process. The software blocks would have otherwise been glass boxes with very expensive automated blinds, now need no blinds and a very little glazing, and are just shaded naturally, and they see green. So it makes a huge difference. So that led us to this last third global program that I'm going to talk to you about, which is in Hyderabad. And Hyderabad, they're now trying to split the state, so it's politically very tense. And they all, because it's an IT city, they all love glass boxes. So now the glass boxes are what's stoned during riots. So the vendors of curtain glazing now give you the fishing nets with very detailed stainless steel details that go with it. So there's a whole new aesthetic that is developing here, which is glass boxes with fishing nets. And they're almost fetishizing those details because it's become so integral. You can increase the tension on the nets if the riot's going to be very big, for example. If the boulders will be bigger. So it's really fascinating. So we were looking at this, and then we saw this little hut, which they set up in the summer. The government sets it up in the summer, which is a water cooler that is manned. That little kettle there is where the water is sort of given. And it's a free service. And Carlos, who's sitting here in the audience, who was an intern at our office, actually made this video for us. Thank you, Carlos. So he documented this guy. He comes to work. You see his kettle down there. He's ready for business. It's all free. People come. They just put their hand out. They don't pay for cups or anything. We just bring cold water, it's very actively used, as you can see. And then every once in a while, he puts the kettle down and he comes out and sprays a little water. Just simple, passive, low-tech cooling, which was very, very interesting. And at that point, I had been looking at all these green buildings all over the West, and stuff with green. So how can this inspire us to do? And then these are earthen pots that are also cooled by evaporation, which is very interesting. And so we came up with a building where we essentially used the idea of a green facade, but as a veil, not as a green facade that's stuck on the building, and put in a misting system, which actually keeps this thing wet, so therefore it's cool with that. And it's 5 floors high, but it also allows you to have gardens on each facade, which are different species depending on the sun and all of that, and it becomes a dynamic facade. And it's really a spec building. So that was my way of dealing with the impatience of the capital. We built the spec building with the aluminium windows, a concrete frame structure. They occupied it. And then we took 2.5 years to make the frame, which we got built in a small, and that's the podium where we lifted the ground. And that's what it looks like finished. But we got, and in section, it's interesting because there are two courtyards that help the air ventilate. We, of course, invest in a lot of details. So I don't want to undermine the investment in the architecture. I'm only focusing on the bigger ideas. And so, of course, we spent a lot of time detailing it, and it's got very nice moments. But the misting system and cooling it and the dynamic facade were the big idea. And it gave us the luxury, by isolating these two elements, to let capital begin to make its profit, while we went to a little village, and the guy who had made the screens for us in the machine tool company set up a little unit, and we handmade a cast aluminium trellis. It has, you know, beautiful texture, but also it was a way of engaging a local economy versus just going to a vendor to extrude it. It's got a profile so that the misting system can sit in it and be accommodated. You know, it uses one mold, and they hired 20 people and gave them jobs for the year or two. So this was a coming together of these two contingencies that were coming to architecture, vocabulary, and a series of elements, but also as a way of isolating this from the contingencies of what capital had in mind in order to be sort of realized. And that's what sort of it looks like finished. And every floor, there's a catwalk with a hydroponic tray that allows the gardeners to walk around. Now, in a corporate building, usually in India, the gardeners will be in the garden. They'll see the boss coming in a Mercedes Benz. They'll kind of know what he does. But here, the gardeners penetrate the building. Everyone working in the building knows the gardeners. They actually request the gardeners to cut the green a little bit so they get a better view. Or they say, look, can you put something with flowers here, you know, etc. So the gardeners have been socialized in the building as a result of this. And this is, again, this idea of softening the thresholds, creating this porosity. And so when you sit in the conference room, as this is Carlos, who went to document this building, you see the blinds are down. They chose to put the blind, but you see the gardeners in action from the boardroom. But the gardeners can work there, and they can penetrate visually any moment of the office, which would otherwise been totally exclusive to them. So for me, that becomes a way of operationalizing some of the things I'm talking about. Now, these local programs. Now, this is a Magic Bus, which is an NGO that works with slum children. And they take slum children for a weekend retreat for education, nutrition, etc. And the brief was, again, here, because this is what's being perpetuated as the narrative, make us a caricature of an Indian village. It'd be nice for the kids to go to a rural environment. But now that was problematic for me, again, in the ways I was talking about reversing this. So we created this campus with a series of pavilions, so we disaggregated a great deal, and there are pavilions that sit on this beautiful landscape. But what we set ourselves as a constraint was that we would use materials that exist in the slums, but reconfigure them, with the hope that kids would be inspired, that when they're remaking their own houses, when they're teenagers, they might use these same materials in different ways, articulate it in different ways. Because I think, I'm not saying slums should exist forever, but they won't go away in a hurry. So even if people's lives improve for the short term, this question of time, I think, becomes important. And so we went further and then began to say, even as typologies, can we use them as types that can be re-embedded in the slums as clinics and education centers and public toilets, etc. And began to engage in NGOs with this, and they're very simple materials. These are the dorms. This is the dining room, just cement floors, metal with bamboo chicks. This is how the dorm works. But it doesn't get trapped in the aesthetic of the caricature of the Indian vernacular of the look. And it's very light as buildings, so they can be dismantled, reconfigured, and built very easily in environments. This is the gateway building with the administration. We added a terrace. These were just our own exercises to imagine what would happen. And at that point, we said, let's try to make this operational. This became a self-initiated project. We talked to an NGO. And Ricky Burdett here was very much part of some of this discussion with Urban Age when they were in Mumbai. And we looked at the statistics on this, and they're really appalling. I mean, you know, it's going to be 3 billion people in 2050, according to projections, that are going to live in conditions like that or close to that, which is mind-boggling within the urban. And then again, this question of how do you anticipate? So, I mean, this little child who comes out of the slum, going to school, white shirt, white socks, totally intact, trying to live a life, but no access to toilets. So this is the statistics. There's one toilet for 1,440 people in Mumbai. It's mind-boggling that women and children especially have to defecate just outside their homes because they have no access to these places. The NGOs think 1:800. The municipal corporation's target is 1:50. So their aspiration also doesn't include giving 4 or 6 people a toilet, which is really quite appalling. And so this is what happens to the toilets, as you all know. So we came up with this type where what we did was stack the toilets so the women and children can be safer, more comfortable. We put a community center together with the caretaker's house on top of the toilet. So the lowest caste person who cleans the toilet suddenly has the penthouse and has incredible pride in the toilet as a reversal of this whole thing. And there's a community center there. And then I went to one of my clients who we had done a weekend house for, and he was so guilt-ridden when I told him this story. He gave me money for solar panels for all these toilets. So we put solar panels because that gets the toilet off the grid, which means the contractors don't put the lights out at night when the women and children really need to use the toilet. And kids can have education on the community center because they can use it at night. So this is what sort of we did. And we proposed it, and I was speaking to Ricky yesterday about the problems with this project because he'd been part of these discussions. And the government revolted violently to this. We did about 8 or 10 locations. And this toilet, when it was built up to 3 or 4 feet off the ground, they came and stopped the project. Because this, it reverses their imagination, which is removing the slums and building public housing. And you're legitimizing the slum by building this. I believe the public housing won't happen. It is not happening. And even if these sort of serve people for 10 years, I think they've served their purpose because it's taken a generation over the threshold of sanitation. And we did many proposals and none got built. And so we told the NGO, let's go to a really remote site and build one. So we built one. And it worked very well for about 3 or 4 months with the solar panels and everything. And then it failed terribly because when I went back a few weeks ago, I saw the men had taken it over as their den. They had a television set. They were bottles of whiskey because they got this wonderful space with breeze and things. And then I realized the NGO did not have its roots in this remote slum that we had chosen. So this was a mistake. We really didn't have a client. We were just ambitious as architects to build a prototype. And I mean, the point I'm trying to make is I think we can play a big role. There are 400 toilets being made in Mumbai right now. There are no architects involved in it. So we can play, and the profession has to engage with these questions in this sense of elasticity that I was talking about, where the protocols are completely different. We have to relearn that whole process. And I think it's a huge, huge challenge. But anyway, we've learned from it. And I'm going to end with this project, which is a low-cost housing project. That's my client. Both those people there are my clients, the elephant and the mahout. This is a mahout. They are Muslim. They live in Jaipur. It's an accident of history that they are in Jaipur because the Mughals bought the elephants there for ceremony. These are tropical beings, but now they live there. There are 100 of them. They take tourists up to the fortress. They work in terribly appalling conditions. And the government floated a competition to create housing for the Mahouts. And they weren't interested. There was a lot of pressure on them to do it. And Rajasthan, don't forget, is a right-wing Hindu state somewhat. I mean, it has a Congress government now, but it's got leanings. And so these were our clients. And this is what they do, that's where they live. And the site the government gave us, it was a competition. And I think the other entries fetishized the architecture. So they used the prototype of the stables that the Maharajas had, which was very formal architecture for the elephants. And we made it a landscape project because we realized that both housing but the health of the elephants was dependent on water. And so it was a site that had been quarried by sand contractors. So it was basically big holes, which worked to our advantage because what we did was just created a series of very inexpensive check dams to hold the water and to transform. And luckily, the government there was so unstable that they weren't water bodies, landscape. The public works department said it's not in our spec. But because the government kept collapsing, the holes kept getting filled up once we had put the check dams. And once the landscape generated itself, they became open to idea. So this was the site as we got it. Essentially put the housing in areas that could not be flooded once the water sort of was collected. And there was a whole logic of the contours and what species were planted and studies in terms of, 100 elephants for a year need 10 million liters of water. And what we've managed to date, and this is not even complete now, it's an ongoing project, we've managed 20 million liters. So we've doubled the amount that elephants need, which means you can really regenerate the whole landscape in the process. And so that's really the master plan. And then, of course, it became a housing problem because the spec called for row housing. But we realized that low-cost housing, where the requirement is only 40 square meters per family, 400 square feet a family, with the elephant sort of parked there in a garage, and children and all of that. So we sort of created a hierarchy of courtyards. So again, it was elastic. People could appropriate it over time. And this will transform. It'll be a wonderful project for me to visit after 10 years. Right now, we've sort of given up on the architecture because really getting the water there was more important. And of course, we studied it in detail. There were models. I mean, it's not like we didn't privilege the architecture, but we kept failing in trying to get it executed. And so this is a typical cluster with the elephant. And the elephant has to be separated because it's dangerous for the kids. The mahout is the only one who has a very intimate relationship with the elephants, a very complex relationship. And that's why the water becomes important, because through the process of bathing, they bond with the elephants. And so that whole equation was really, for us, integral to the design questions. And that's what a site. But, you know, elephants also are small, medium, large, and extra large. So we had to configure the houses depending on the volume of the elephant. And elephants can't lie on flat ground. They always lie on berms. So you have to actually angle it. So these were tests that we did on site with these gentle beasts. And then the water and the housing got built first. The water started accumulating slowly. They didn't move these people in there till last year. So for the first 3 years of the projects, the elephants would walk all the way 5 kilometers from their present accommodation just to bathe, because it changed their health, their temperament, their makeup, all of that. But then this is what's happened in 3 years. That's how we got the site. And in 3 years, that's the change in the ecology of the site, which is what now the government is supporting. And this is an image I took before people moved in. The site just regenerated itself naturally. And that became the platform then for us to negotiate with the government. And now, of course, they're starting to plant within the living areas. All that green that you see has been introduced as a result of the water being there. And it's this process that's very, very important, because I think the bathing for the elephants, and you know, this is, they have to walk on tarmac roads to go to work. It's actually just totally, well, inhuman or whatever the right word might be. But you know, it's, I mean, I think the landscape being privileged meant a complete change in their makeup because of the access they had to water. And these, of course, early images when the water body was just beginning to get established after the first monsoon. And now, I mean, you know, the ecology just sort of regenerates itself. It's robust enough to do that. And it's this process that really is the success of the project, that one can facilitate a relationship like this for people who earn about 5,000 rupees a month. So they earn less than $1,000 and maybe $20 more in tips when the tourists take them up there. So it's really low-cost housing. And I mean, even the elephants now, you know, I mean, they can, for example, you'll see in the next image, they can have a snack on their way to work because there's grass there. And it's interesting, you can see the trees. I mean, I think it will evolve with time. And of course, now families have moved in. Each cluster is transforming differently as ways people occupy these places. You can see how the elephants sort of, and now the government is supporting us with funds to create more water bodies, to line them so the elephants can more easily walk into them as ramps. And you can see, it's just amazing how, this is an image I took 2-3 weeks ago. It's completely regenerated itself as an environment. You know, and there are moments there between the water bodies where it's almost forest-like and tropical once more. But it's also created a sense of community, because these kids now have space. The elephants are sort of, you can see them watching over the kids here. It's a changed environment. So that's with that, I'm just going to spend a minute to conclude. And what I want to say is that, you know, as the world and South Asia, India, because we're focusing on what we might learn from an Indian context, in particular as these places become increasingly global, we have to be cautious about accepting that things are growing more alike because they begin to look more alike. Because when we engage with the deeper excavation of the site on which we operate, and this is an understanding, I believe, that draws both on objective realities as well as subjective perceptions of the site, the differences actually emerge more strikingly than before, where differences were actually assured when things look different. And I think this is something we have to be very cautious about. Thus, architects will have to find necessarily in terrains like this, and that's why I think even these local programs, how one can engage local practitioners who can understand some of that pulse is very critical, because we have to find more rigorous ways of defining the complex emerging cultural fabric of multiple aspirations in these societies. in societies of, you know, mutinous democracies, for example, like India, where mobility is very unpredictable. And more importantly, to see this cultural fabric as an ever-evolving landscape. I mean, I think this is critical because, you know, this it drives me mad when I'm expected to be an Indian architect and understand a cultural landscape, whereas my American counterparts are not expected to be American architects. It really hinges on this idea that culture can be seen as a static phenomena. It's actually as much a process or a project of construction as anything else. And so in the words of Arjun Appudarai, the anthropologist, he says, culture is a dialogue between aspirations and sedimented traditions. Sedimented traditions is also a project of excavation and how you begin to discern it. So in these interpretations that we as designers make of a place or culture, ideas of the future, as much as those of the past, have to be necessarily embedded and nurtured. Thus, the highly pluralistic environment or the landscape of India, South Asia, I think, requires planning and design mechanisms and attitudes that continually negotiate between the differences. Architecture is the sole instrument of placemaking and the temporality that creates the conditions of habitation and celebration, as I sort of described in the phenomenon of the kinetic city, the negotiations between the state and the market, the empowered and the poor, rather than allowing one entity to remake the city in its image. And I think this is what differentiates democracies from autocracies, perhaps. And I think this is what makes working in Mumbai and the landscape of India really unique and challenging. And once the architect sees these differences as being simultaneously valid, I think that's the critical move. The challenge then is how to go beyond their polarized binaries to facilitate the coexistence, the adjacencies, and those tensions that exist. And I think that's truly the space in which we, I believe, will engage with architecture and as an extension with society more meaningfully. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Rahul. Wonderful, wonderful talk. We're going to take a few questions now.
Yeah, sure, sure.
Let me, as they settle, I would have a first question, which I won't ask, which is the name of a graduate from the AA, which we'll save for dinner later. although that made me think of another AA-related question, and I couldn't help but, in sketching a few thoughts to introduce you this evening, wander back to a period now well over a half a century ago where figures like Maxwell Fry leave the AA, go to India to set up the Department of Tropical Architecture, it was called at the time, which very quickly Otto Königsberger takes over and, in fact, evolves a very interesting generation of Europeans and others engaging many of the kinds of problems you've shown tonight. The question it prompts would be, in the incredibly compelling and interesting both projects and research you're doing, what you come back to over and over again is the question of time, is the feature of time in the world, and in fact how cities change in time, how built space changes, your interest in that being a part of the projects you're realizing. And of course there's another category of time now with the kind of problem you're engaging, which is the time in which this kind of work has been done. In fact, that there now is a half century of this kind of work that offers, at least in different ways, a sort of genealogy to this incredibly interesting work now. And I'm wondering if there's anything in the research you're doing, for example, with the students that might be going back and looking at some of those previous attempts, and whether, in fact, there might or might not be either lessons or pitfalls that could give us a way to frame and look at the kind of incredible examples. Yeah.
You know, I mean, I think there is a lot, that's a great question. I think there's a lot documented, so the research exists. I think the big difference is the shifting patronage, because it's a shift in patronage from the state all the way from the 50s to the generation of first generation of post-independent architects like Charles Correa, Doshi, Rajarava. It was the state. You know, when I went back to start practicing in 1990s, when they announced liberalization, and in 3 years it became an incredible gray zone because the government put their hands up on everything, and the private sector was yet greedy and impatient, and you know all of that. And so that's when one realized that these multiple transitions. So sometimes, I mean, like that project for the elephants, it comes out of socialist policies, but it's not supported in the way there would have been a commitment 20 years ago. So they have it on paper. They have the public works department that's executing it like a state-given project. But they don't have their heart in it. They have all the excuses not to do it because we're beginning to liberalize, we're capitalists. And the capitalists or private enterprise is not beginning to engage with this. And you know, capital slows down as it begins to reside in foundations and museums and institutions is when it really becomes patient. And so I think we are in India going through that process. So like even the Herzog de Meuron Museum in Calcutta, it's like they've been talking about it for 7 or 8 years. They haven't even started because foundations yet don't have the patience or the confidence to harness capital in that way, because they're all, we're going through that phase of greed right now in India where everyone's trying to build their capital, not let it reside patiently. And unless it resides patiently, I think you can't make good architecture. And so that's why these projects are kind of complicated and difficult, or you have to be very strategic and you have to maneuver your way in interesting sort of ways. And that's why, you know, the projects that you see which are celebrated now, which are NGOs building in Africa and other places. This is big capital that has become patient in America that goes with the architect to Africa. Yeah. It's not local capital that is deployed for those things. So it's a whole different, those being set up as models is problematic, because I mean, I think some of these local programs have to be nurtured locally with capital that resides there, with professionals that reside there. And I think that's the same thing is true for America. And again, I'm going to quote Farshid on this, because I think she raised this question too, is that in America, you know, architects are willing to go to India or Africa with this capital to deploy stuff, but they're not willing to engage with Detroit and Minneapolis or, you know, on the outskirts of some suburban condition which are as distraught. And so it's architects following patronage in a sense. I think so the patronage question, I think, becomes an interesting one. I don't know if that sort of answers
it. Yeah, let me pass the microphone around. Yep.
Hi, my name's Nick. I'm a student in the LSE Cities program, where I think, thanks to Ricky, half of us wrote papers about kinetic urbanism last term. My question is about this. It seems like this turn now, this maybe a temporal turn, that there's a sort of global conversation where there seems to be two sets. There's sort of the Mumbai export, including kinetic urbanism, and so the user-generated urbanism of the herbs guys. And then there's this whole other aspect of like pop-up, adaptable, this whole sustainability giving way to resilience and adaptability. I think Berkeley's holding a conference in September on adaptable urbanism. And there seems to be one strain that's sort of coming out of informal settlement, you know, Bombay, South America, and another strain that's coming from technology, where there's pop-up, user-generated, and open source cities and stuff like that. Where do you fit your theory into this sort of conversation? What do you see? How would you tell that story? Because you obviously come into contact with people that have the same kinds of ideas.
Well, for me, I think the more important thing is how you situate this within a broader meta-narrative of what the problems are and the question is, and how you deploy this. So this is, I'm not proposing, when I say the kinetic city, I'm not proposing that as a solution, but I'm proposing that as an other narrative. It could be a holding strategy, it could, but it's just trying to make sense of the logic by which that phenomena organizes itself, by which it expands margins that you would not have imagined otherwise in terms of uses and strategies such as those. And I clearly see these as holding strategies. And I think these could be deployed all the way from emergency housing and settlements to urban fluxes that might ripple through our geographies, both in the West and in the South, and the North and the South, and they become holy. So we, as architects, we are programmed to think of permanent solutions. And so this, I think, critiques that sensibility. And it basically, I mean, I think at least my drive or my intention is to construct a narrative, because I just think the narrative of the informal city is for me non-productive for us to intervene, because it doesn't allow us to situate it within these meta-narratives. It's becoming an end in itself. And like I said, then you have to have your alliance and you become the informal city guy, you know, which is, I think we have to be more elastic even in our professional engagement model. So that's, I think, really the argument.
We'll see if there's a last question. Yeah, hey, hello. Anish Kapoor, are you actually like into him? Some people say he's only a hashtag these days.
He's a what?
Hashtag on Twitter, like hashtag. Like only an issue, not even an architect. Some say he's a charlatan. Are you into him?
Who?
Anish Kapoor.
Who's he?
Yeah, that's right. Good one.
No, I'm not into him. No, I mean, I think he's an interesting artist. I mean, is your question that has he stepped into the realm of architecture? I mean, you're asking me to critique that?
In London, we hear Indian architecture. People say Anish Kapoor immediately.
Oh, really?
Not really?
Not everyone.
I'm not an architect.
I'm sorry, I don't know how to answer your question.
Hi.
Maybe
from
over a drink or something.
Hi. I would like to understand your how do you see these cities like Mumbai, for example? Do you think they're collapsing inwards and they need to of course they're it's more what do you call it? It's coming to an end. Like, so how do you see it as a how would you reverse the process probably? How would you?
No, I mean, I don't know. I mean, that's. I wish I had the silver bullet for you. But but I think what is happening is what I described, this process of involution, where we are celebrating and getting obsessed and fetishizing the internal complexity as a positive. And I think that is not an end in itself. It's taking us into disaster. And I think all cities, I mean, the Urban Age Project demonstrates this so vividly, is about the most robust in urban systems are the ones that can become internally efficient and complex, but also diversify simultaneously into more dynamic modes so that they grow in sensible ways, they engage their hinterlands in sensible ways, they open up land, deploying mobility as a form of indirect subsidy for housing, and, you know, so those become the dynamic modes I'm referring to. So it's a complex sort of process, but essentially it can't be one of the two. It's about balances. No? In the world too, we are realizing you've had too much communism, too much capitalism. We have to swing somewhere in between all of this. And I mean, I think even the proposition of trying to build a narrative around the kinetic city is to just bring in these other streams that moderate the extremes that otherwise we so naturally fall into, both in our pedagogy as well as in eventually our practice.
Thank you. Let me do one here and then we'll come over.
Hello, my name's Priya. I think we actually corresponded about my work on Navi Mumbai. Your talk's given me a lot to think about in terms of the future expansion of Bombay. But I was wondering if you would mind putting on kind of historians, from a historian's perspective, I don't know if you could kind of comment on the expansion of Greater Mumbai over the last 30 years and to what degree do you think it's taken into account the kinetic city, which is a clear reality and has been during that period?
Again, this could be a very long answer, but I'll sort of try to be as brief. I think in the 60s, when New Bombay was first proposed, it absolutely was a reaction to that reality in ways that the metropolitan imagination was sort of played out. And I believe, in my own analysis, that it was embraced very easily by the politicians then, because it struck out to make a gesture towards the hinterland of Maharashtra, which is the state that Mumbai is an appendix to, because Mumbai's real hinterland is Gujarat, and the Maharashtrian politicians were anxious about that, so they embraced it. But they had really no desire to propel it as a city, because all the natural investments, because the train system went in the north-south direction to Gujarat, all the investments occurred in that north-down direction. And so that's what change the form of what could potentially have been the Greater Mumbai region.
You know, I'll say a kind of a comment that leads to a question. I found the lecture incredibly interesting in the way you are pursuing the urban through the architecture. Or using your own words, you connect the kind of the strategic through the tactical. Now, you can do this because you're an architect. So the question for you, as in a way, as the head of a department of urban design and planning, is how do we teach that as an isolated exercise? Now, how do we make sure that we have students who are studying the urban or doing the research in urban, but are equipped with tactical tools, which are architecture. I think it's super refreshing. I mean, you could, on the one hand, we could say that the work you do in terms of tactics, perhaps each one of them is, of course, unique and certain circumstances, but you could say in terms of tactics, perhaps as a separate phenomenon, they've been done perhaps at other moments in history. But what is really important is the fact that you are actually implementing them, having this urban and planning
perspective
strategies in mind. Yeah. And the fact that you are now, you have a huge hat of you know, urban and planning in mind, and that we need to remember that actually your power and insightfulness is based on the fact that you are an architect. So how do you go back and teach this to students who are not architects?
Well, luckily it's only half the department that's not architects. But you know, no, I mean, no, I think that's a, I mean, we are struggling with that, as you know. Farshid knows we are struggling with this.
No, we are.
So no, look, I mean, at least at the GSD, there are two or three things that we're trying. One is we're trying to, or at least I'm trying to formulate what might be the appropriate, because, you know, when I, and again, I'm being transparent, honest, and spontaneous about this, but when one took over the department to chair it, I realized that planners were being taught what you could, like Bud Light, call urban design light. So all the studios were essentially, you took blocks and divided them into streets and then had massing. No, so it was a problem because you were just making poor urban designers who had no instincts of an architect, which is what you're. Now, I think it's impossible to have people trained as architects, but I think you can bring the design instinct to bear through pedagogy. And I think in the formulation, which is what we are experimenting with the studio format, the planning studio format, we're doing exactly this. Dan Dioka, who is Interborough in New York, works with these strategies, but using design. But design then gets expanded into designing apps for Apple, you know, to be able to, but it gets all the way from there to physical networking, which are more complex in terms of creating these strategies. So I think the challenge really is how one then helps develop these instincts of designers without being architects necessarily, but design is also an instinct in the way of seeing possibilities, connecting the dots in different ways, and maybe bringing that to bear somewhat spatially. And so I think this is what we are trying to consciously construct studios to do, and a lot of the studios now we're constructing and planning is partnering designers with theoreticians and beginning to embed seminars, beginning to embed questions of designing strategy as part of the exercise versus just physical space, but doing that in concurrence. Now, as an extension of that, I think another forum that's very critical, and the Kumbh Mela, and I'll just tell you why I got involved in that, was I'd done about four or five studios looking at Mumbai, unfortunately, and not at all these other interesting places. And these were interdisciplinary studios with the business school, and da-da-da, you know, so they were celebrated, and everyone thought this was a great deal, and I was so disappointed by them, because by the last week when they had a desperate deadline, those two spoke to each other because they had to present, but there was no interdisciplinarity. I think unless you can transgress each other's disciplines, you don't have interdisciplinarity, you don't work. So for me, the Kumbh Mela became very interesting as an experiment in interdisciplinarity. So what Diana Eck and I did for a whole semester before we went to the site with 40 students and the faculty, we ran a seminar for 3 hours every day. And what was very interesting was even the designers had no perception of what to expect. Because this was a mega city which was temporary around, based on religion. So I could, or my students could transgress the space of the divinity school students as much as they could transgress our space as designers. And I think that learning of being able to pose the discussion both in terms of strategy and what might be tactics to deploy this, I mean, I'm just using those because we were, it was absolutely, and this is what now, my challenge here with this project now is how do you communicate this? Because every one of those disciplines, that's the next step, have their own culture of communicating and their acceptance or the credit they get from their peers, no? So public health would want peer-reviewed journals, GSD would be happy with a lookbook with lovely images, divinity would want scholarly, I think. And we are struggling with how we can bring what was, I think, truly an interdisciplinary experience to be synthesized as a way of communicating. Because for the students, that would be very interesting, to be able to take away from it a process where they've felt they've transgressed each other's disciplines to some extent. So, I mean, it's not a complete answer, but I think it's the process at least I'm personally engaged with as a way to see how, within the constraints we have, because we have planners who are not architects, to bring them into the fold, to be able to think strategically as design might do. I don't know, it's, yeah.
Thank you. I think I saw another, let me just go to the back here. There've been one or two. Sorry? Yeah.
Thanks a lot for your presentation. Fantastic work. I wanted to ask you, I find a contrast between your urban theory, let's say, and the architecture you have, like, I feel the architecture, at least you, what you showed, when each building wants to kind of sit in a garden, and I think the kind of elasticity and the kinetic nature of things what you're talking about is, I mean, I think it can span from a very, very urban nature to, let's say, like an anti-urban kind of settings. I think the elasticity of things should change in India from the very urban nature of it to like to a very kind of anti-urban kind of situation through if you understand the kind of deep revolution between what happens in the IT sector and with the power of computation and all that. So I just wanted to ask you, what is your take on the notion of anti-urban, like, or the, you know, if you are not, if you were just an architect and if you were not a planner or an urban planner, what would your take on your buildings like?
Actually, I'm not an urban planner by training. I'm only an architect, as you said. So, no, I mean, I'm not proposing this again as a design tool. I mean, I think what I get from those readings goes into how one engages in terms of the models of practice, the protocols, the elasticity with which one can slide sideways as a professional and engage with these disparate landscapes, conditions, economic groups. It just gives one a more nuanced reading of a different kind of reality. And so what one learns with preservation projects by embedding certain narratives in there, or low-cost housing, I mean, it gives one the ability or the confidence that one can excavate those sites on which appropriate strategies and tactics can be founded. So I think that's really, for me, or the lesson that I'm trying to share. I don't have any, I mean, I have to think this through or articulate it better, but I don't have I'm not making this proposition as a, I mean, I'm looking at different landscapes like the small towns. That's one of the research projects we are starting at the GSD and things, and one will learn from it in terms of particular geographies. But right now, I think what I'm sharing with you is something that I can see more clearly in the last few years. In fact, the first time I spoke about my own projects was only a year ago at the annual Loeb Fellowship lecture. It's always been talking either about the city or about preservation or about Mumbai. So I'm also in the process of trying to create, to construct this in a way that it feedbacks, it creates feedback loops for my own projects. So maybe the question of the urban or the anti-urban, I might be able to articulate in the coming months or years.
Thanks. I think we've got one more question in the back here.
Hi. You spoke about the Kumbh Mela, and you said that your research there, along with the GSD, holds some key, probably some keys into how you would develop 393 growing cities in India. Could you elaborate on some of the systems or spatial characteristics of the spaces in the Kumbh Mela, which could possibly be used to treat the growing population in the 393 cities?
Yeah, well, I mean, I don't think there's a direct correlation. I think what I've learned from the Kumbh Mela is two or threefold. I mean, right now, we're just there 2 weeks ago, so one is yet taking. I haven't even downloaded the images from my camera yet, so it's too early to very authoritatively say something. But I think what it's made me do is to, by seeing a religious town like that, look at the question of taxonomy, because I think the 392 cities, which is the urban time bomb that India is sitting on, are only cut by size of population, which is crazy to be thinking of policy just based on that. So if one can create a taxonomy, for example, religious towns, why can't the temple trusts be part of the governing sort of dynamics of it? Temple towns are elastic because at pilgrimage time, 9-10 million people come there, otherwise they're 2 million people. The government is making infrastructure like the American way for a city of 10 million people when no one is around, like football stadiums that are used 2 times in a year, etc. So therefore, again, this question of elasticity, which will come out of the taxonomy that one creates as the primary primary drivers in this whole process. So that's one level at which one, I think, is inspired by this process. The second is just the deployment of infrastructure, of the balance between social infrastructure and physical infrastructure. It's incredible how, you know, they have clinics and hospitals and fire brigade stations and police stations and schools. It's amazing how that place is organized. So that's, I think, the other is private-public, because here what happens, as opposed to refugee camps, what they do is they lay out a grid, and then they give entire blocks to what are called akhadas. Akhadas are religious groups. There are 13 of them. And then there are many other such faith-based ashrams and things who apply for land. So they're given a block of land. And each one of these groups have between 5,000 and 50,000 people who form part of that community. And then within that block, they self-organize themselves. So you get a city that's on a perfect grid with 163 kilometers of road made by metal plates that are put and then recycled, to sanitation, to water supply, to electricity. They have a sound system that covers the entire city, 10 kilometers long, 4 kilometers wide, to announce for children who get lost, women who get old, women who get lost, etc. So it's and now, because it happens in India for 55 days, everyone can have the energy to do it. I mean, I don't think in India they'd manage something like this, you know, forever. I hope they will someday. So, I mean, I think the learning is about also how one can deploy this in terms of the governance structure, responsibility. Refugee camps become repetitive aggregation of tents. So communities have no facility within the spatial organization of something like this to self-organize, which means there is no bonding. That Kenyan camp with 600,000 people has been around for 20 years. Children have been born and become teenagers and got married. And there is no sense of community in these places. So spatially, I think one can also learn how this organization takes. So there are many levels, and I'm hoping, but you know, we shouldn't also be speaking about this just as a planner or an urban designer or an architect, and this would be interesting to see what the School of Religion made of this, what public health has trained volunteers, and they're staying on for 55 days to monitor air quality, water quality, spikes in diseases when these influx of people come in. So I don't know, and this is why the challenge of how one synthesizes this interdisciplinarity is critical. I don't even want to make the judgments about what is the right size of the grid till I can hear from the other experiences. And I think that will be important. So,
hi. LSC Cities Program. I'm particularly interested in self-construction processes. Mm-hmm. And my question is, in trying to understand your concept of the kinetic and the static, how do you define the self-construction process as it transforms itself in time, but as it also, cities also, I mean, it is constantly celebrating itself, so it's not just the kinetic, but also the static. So, yeah, is it a one more concept, like yeah. Missing, is it the juxtaposition from the theoretical problem?
Yeah, but I mean, I think this is where Brett's observation of time becomes very important, because those things mean different things when you look at different slices of time in terms of, so let me say, for example, low-cost housing, if one can create the DNA where it can grow incrementally, you know, a settlement like that might be much denser and become a real part of the city with much more invested in the materiality of the architecture. Or it might fail as an operation and no investments be made there. So that would differ substantially. But again, I'm not implying that the kinetic city idea is a design proposition. It's rather an imagination that temporality can play a role in the way we can absorb urban fluxes in design terms, rather than in, you know, just imagining and observing and then fetishizing something that happens laissez faire and calling it the informal city.
Hello, Sunan Prasad. That was astonishing, wonderful insights, really a tremendous tour. And thinking about the combination of realism and optimism that you sort of symbolize through in this talk, I felt to, well, first of all, I remembered the prayer, which is a Catholic prayer, but it could easily be a Hindu prayer, which is that, Lord, give me the strength not to try and change what I can't, and to do what I can to change what I can, and to be able to have the wisdom to tell the difference, which you are doing. But in that is an acceptance, in a way, that these deposits of impatient capital are not resistible. So it's futile to try to, in this phase of development, to resist them, but they are occurring at a scale that is unprecedented in history. Does it leave a project in the future then that at some point there will have to be a recovery of those deposits, a conversion of those, and an incorporation of those into a more productive and civilized future?
Yeah, well, of course, that will be a project because the scale of what's happening is incredible. But I yet sort of reinforce my optimism that I think through tactical and strategic moves and spatial imaginations, I think there's a way that one can embed that impatient capital in the landscape in more rooted ways. And I think this is the big design challenge. And I mean, I think for me, that building in Hyderabad is one way of configuring space that you can, you know, combine not only those economies, but also combine the access, create a new expression perhaps, be inspired by other excavations of the site. But you're right, the scale of this that's happening, even architect-less, is so enormous that I think that'll be a challenge in the future. Either people will boil to death when the air conditioning fails or something else will have to happen. But it's deadly. I mean, it really is. Like that building in Jaipur, that's the World Trade Center in Jaipur, a government project. I mean, it's just totally ridiculous.
Rahul, thank you so much for coming in this evening. Everybody join me in thanking Rahul.